Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Lord Jesus, our true High Priest, make us worthy to commemorate the bishops and the priests who have passed from this life. They cared for your flock, served at your divine altars, and celebrated your holy mysteries. May they share in the heavenly reward of the faithful bishops and priests, that with them they may sing glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the Father who chose priests, and to the Son who entrusted the service of his mysteries to them, and to the Holy Spirit who sanctified their offerings. To the good one be glory and honor on this day of their blessed commemoration, and all the days of our lives and forever.
Amen.
Glory and thanks to you, O High Priest, our Lord Jesus Christ, for your priesthood is eternal. Today we remember our faithful bishops and priests who have finished their service and who have departed from this world. How precious in your eyes is the death of your righteous ones. They carried you in their hands, and they invited your faithful people to your banquet. They proclaimed your word and your good tidings, and they diligently cared for your flock. Now, O Lord, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to receive them and to forgive them for any shortcomings in their service. As you honor them in this life, clothe them with the glory of your priesthood and robe of the righteous, within the sanctuary of your apostles Peter and Paul, who faithfully served you. Count them among the children of light in the church of the firstborn. May they enjoy the graces of your holy mysteries that they once celebrated in the company of the blessed prophets, apostles, bishops, and priests. With them we raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Priests who had changed bread and wine.
who has taught them. Give thanks to the Spirit who comes when they call him to rest on their pure sacrifice. Give God glory. O Lord, accept our prayers and the fragrance of our incense, and may the priests who have celebrated your holy mysteries and have departed from us receive the reward of the good and faithful servant. In the abundance of your grace, forgive all their sins and remember on your heavenly altar all the good things they once offered to you. May they share in the reward of all your saints, and with them may we raise glory and thanks to you forever.
Amen.
Kadishant, aloho, kodishant, hayalato, no kodishant, just who are faithful and the priests who served you, Lord, find their rest in your glory in Jerusalem on high.
Lord God, you accepted what the just had offered you. Now accept
reading from the first letter of St. Paul to Timothy.
Glory to the Lord of Paul and the apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish and your children forever.
If you will give these instructions to the brothers and sisters, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus, nourished on the words of the faith and on the sound teaching you have followed. Avoid profane and silly myths. Train yourself for devotion. For while physical training is of limited value, devotion is valuable in every respect, since it holds a promise of life, both for the present and for the future. This saying is trustworthy and deserves full acceptance. For this we toil and struggle, because we have set our hope on the living God, who is the Savior of all, especially those who believe. Command and teach these things, Let no one have contempt for your youth, but set an example for those who believe in speech, conduct, love, faith, and purity. Until I arrive, attend to the reading, exhortation, and teaching. Do not neglect the gift you have, which was conferred upon you through the prophetic word with the imposition of hands and of the presbyteriate. Be diligent in these matters, be absorbed in them, so that your progress may be evident to everyone. Attend to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in both tasks, for by doing so, you will save both yourself and those who listen to you. Praise be to God always. Alleluia. Alleluia. I will clothe her priests with salvation, and her faithful shall ring out their joy.
Alleluia.
Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Shlomo elu kuluchunem. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Saint Luke, who proclaimed life unto the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Lord Jesus says, "Who then is the faithful and prudent steward whom the master shall put in charge of his servants in order to distribute the food allowance at its proper time? Blessed is that servant whom his master, upon his arrival, finds doing so. For truly I say to you, he shall place him in charge of all his property. But if that servant says within himself, 'My master is delayed in coming,' and he begins to beat the men servants and the maid servants, to eat and to drink and to get drunk, then that servant's master shall come on an unexpected day, and at an unknown hour, and he will punish him severely and assign him a place with the unfaithful. That servant who knew his master's will, but did not make preparations nor act in accord with his will, shall be beaten severely. And the servant who was ignorant of his master's will, but who acted in a way deserving of a severe beating, shall be beaten only lightly. Much will be required of the man entrusted with much, and still more shall be demanded of the man entrusted with more." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Lord.
Much will be demanded of him to whom much has been entrusted. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Now, a few weeks ago, we considered the notion of the church as being the synodos, the path together, as we move along, and the gospel being, by its very essence, message. We receive in order to communicate. And we know in the history of the church, along this path that has gone on for 2,000 years now, that many individuals obviously have come and they have gone. That many families have come and have gone. Parishes that have come and have gone. And in some instances, entire dioceses that have come and that have gone. But what has always remained with on this path is our Lord's priesthood. From man to man, generation to generation, through thousands of years from the Last Supper until this day, but in fact until the Day of Judgment, there will always be priests. The priests are not just administrators. In fact, administration is low on the totem of what they actually are. These are men who are consecrated for the altar. That is their purpose. They bring the divine mysteries. They are stewards of the divine mysteries. They feed the flock of Christ. That is their purpose. They are not social workers. They do not run NGOs. They are not a celibate administrators of state, if you like. They are consecrated individuals, not through any merit of their own. That's why this very severe gospel that's given today, that the one to whom much has been committed, much shall be demanded. And the one to whom more has been given, even more shall be demanded. It's a response in the gospel to the question of St. Peter, which is actually the question which is not actually said here. This is chapter 12 of St. Luke. And as always, I encourage you to go and read the whole chapter. There are many parables and images. The image just before the quotation of this gospel today is about the householder. And if you knew when the burglar was coming, you would be attentive. They wouldn't break in because you'd know. So our Lord is using it as the idea of being watchful every moment, every day, every week. We should be ready to die at every moment in our lives. We always think of death as being something far off. But when we speak about death and its judgment that comes, the judgment is just the reality that will take place at the moment of our death. That's all. God doesn't appear in order to punish us. It's just simply now we will be confronted with divine justice and we will see things for the first time in our existence as they truly are. During our lives, we're distracted. We have all kinds of stuff around us. We have Netflix. We have all kinds of things that we just kind of frivolously spin our wheels and waste our days. And every moment of time bears grace. God is always communicating to us. And the tragedy that happens for many individuals is they don't really think about these things until they die. And in that moment of death, there is nothing else to think of except that reality. When all of a sudden the televisions, the people, the shopping, the internet, whatever distracts us during this life are gone. And for the first time in our existences, we will be truly thinking fully, consciously, in perfection. But of course, at that point, you can change nothing. Because at that point, we're confronted with the reality of things. So during this life, what the priesthood is meant is to remind the flock of Christ of these truths, amongst many others. This is why our Lord gives this parable of saying that if the householder knew the time and the hour that the burglar would break in, he would be watchful. He would be awake. He wouldn't be whining, saying, well, it's 3:30 in the morning, it's too early, I can't be bothered, I'll just sleep in. No, they'd be awake. They'd be totally motivated. After the gospel that is quoted today, our Lord goes on and he says, I have come to cast fire upon the earth. And what would I that it be enkindled. May the planet be set on fire. I have not come to bring peace, but the sword, to divide father from children, children from father, mother-in-law from daughter-in-law. He goes through and he talks about the fact that the gospel brings that truth of conscious reality, of knowledge, and an awareness of what we are meant to be as human beings. Not to bring us nice, warm, tingly feelings, but to give us the understanding of what we are meant to be in our individual lives. This is why he calls it fire. And ultimately, the fire is charity. I have come to cast the fire of charity upon the face of the earth. And would I would that it be enkindled now. But this conflagration that spreads across the world divides individual from individual, even within the intimacy of family. Father from children, child from father. And in the midst of these lessons and these parables and that dramatic one of the fire being in conflagration on the face of the earth, we have today's gospel. Because as we go through talking about the judgment, the breaking in, the being watchful at all times, St. Peter steps forward and he asks our Lord, are these lessons for us, the apostles, or for everybody else? And that's why he goes in. Well, who is the good steward? Because the apostles, yes, they're among the faithful. But they are faithful who have a function within that synodos, within that uniform collaborative pathway, which is the church. And that's why he says, well, who is the good and faithful servant? And that's why it's important to remember the very first thing he says is actually about reward. The last three are about punishments, because you've failed or have partially failed in your work as steward. So he's answering St. Peter and the apostles in today's gospel. That's why it's quoted today for the week of the deceased priests. But he says that the steward who has been set up in order to hand out and make sure everyone in the household of all of his fellow servants are being fed and taken care of, he says, well, blessed is that servant that when the master upon his arrival, his coming, finds him doing so. He will place him over everything. In other words, he will make him essentially at his right hand equal to the master. Slightly idea, being steward over everything, he has control. That's the first one, which is praiseworthy. And the next ones, of course, are for the steward who is not faithful. And he says that for the steward who thinks, well, you know, it's not going to be until August that he's going to actually come back. Phew, we have this great pantry. This is really very good, you know. And so he just simply starts ordering everyone around savagely. That's the idea of beating the maidservants, the other fellow servants, making them do what they have to do, do all of this work within the household. But me, I'm the steward. The master's not here. He's delayed. It's going to take some time. So that means I'm head honcho here. And he says to start eating and drinking and to get drunk. And he says that when the master returns, he says, what is interesting there, he says that when the master returns, it will always be on an unknown day and an unknown hour. Why? Because the steward is distracted. So it doesn't matter. Even when we know, this is the amazing thing, even as Catholics, we know that we're going to die. Why does not every Catholic actually die a holy death? That's the steward. You know the master is coming back. You know he's returning. Why are you ransacking the pantry for your own benefit and your own satisfaction eating and drinking? It's an extraordinary thing because, of course, it's very logical that our Lord should say that no matter when the master returns, it will always be, oh, a surprise. It will always be an unknown day. It will always be an unknown hour. And when he returns, he will take that servant. Now, here in our translation, it was very gentle. It says, oh, he'll be punished severely. Actually, what it says in the scriptures is, he will be cut in two, and he will be allocated amongst the portion of the hypocrites. Here they translate it unfaithful. But hypocrites, because hypocrite just means actor, someone who portrayed themselves as being something they were not. We are the children of God. Do we live as the children of God at every moment of our day and all of our thoughts and all of our sentiments? That's what this means. He was meant to be steward. In other words, he had dominion to make flourish the things that belong to the master. But he was a hypocrite. He only acted as having stewardship. Instead, what was he doing? Serving himself. It was about me. It's about my eating, my drinking, my pleasure, my benefit. Bossing other people around. And then he has these two other interesting ones when he says that the servant who doesn't do this will also be severely punished and beaten. But the servant who does not do the master, does not do the master's will also be, and does not prepare, will be severely beaten. So here he's not abusing the other fellow servants. He's just simply doing his job. And then the third one is that the one who makes no preparation but does the will of the master, although he's doing the will of the master, that when the master returns, he's done something without regard, apparently, that is offensive to the master, he will be lightly beaten. This is a good lesson for us in the modern world where we try to talk about intention being everything about morality. Well, she meant well. Well, she might have meant well, but what she did was still objectively wrong. She may not be, as the parable says, be severely beaten. She'll be just beaten lightly, our Lord says. So it's a very fascinating, well worth meditation on this text that is here. But it is because in this week we pray for that essential aspect of the church, which is priesthood. Someday I will be dead, and other priests will also be present in the earth. That chain is essential to the church. That chain will always be present. Whether there is a Maronite parish in Maine or not, there will be Maronite priests someplace. There will be Catholic priests for sure until the end of time. Individuals come and go. Families come and go. Parishes come and go. Entire diocesan churches come and go. But the priesthood will always be present. And so on this first week of the 3 weeks of the dead, we first focus upon those individuals, those men who within the church are both angels and Christ. In our prayers, when we make reference to what is a priest is not an employee. A priest is not an administrator. A priest is not the social worker you mentioned. The priests are the men who are called and consecrated in any given generation to extend the incarnation of God made man through time. That's what the priest is. Through no merit of his own, but there are individuals who are called, and in their consecration of holy orders, they are an extension of the Word incarnate, so that from the point of view of humanity, they are individual men who are lifted into the mystery of the incarnation. They are Christ within the church. They are the voice of Christ within the church and the reality essential in the midst of the body of Christ. But from the point of view of heaven, if you like, this is what's in the prayer of our church this morning, that from the point of view of the divine altar that they serve at, they are like the angels of God. Because they serve in the presence of God on the bema and within the sanctuary. That is their purpose, their function, to be at the altar. And from the aspect of God, then they are the angels that surround him in service within the divinity of the heavenly Jerusalem. So we make reference to the heavenly Jerusalem. May they be brought in the fullness of joy and glory, and be robed in the glory of your priest, and brought into the sanctuary, the Kaddish, into the holy place of St. Paul and St. Peter, your faithful priest. So it's a vision that we have of what the priesthood is. And the Maronite Church is a priestly church. St. Maron was a priest. He was not just an ascetic. He was priest. And his entire ministry, even in his asceticism, was to preach the gospel and to spread that message on the synodos, on the pathway together. But alas,
Are we not all human beings? And we fail in so many things, in thought, word, deed, omission, the things that I should have done that I haven't done. And that is why the glory which is Christ in consecrating them from generation to generation. And I believe I've told you that in the Maronite ordination ceremony, it's quite beautiful, in fact, that the bishop in the middle of the anaphora places his hands on the Blessed Sacrament and then places his right hand on the head of the man being ordained to the priesthood. So that it is actually the Eucharist that consecrates the man who is meant to be consecrated to consecrate the Eucharist. And so it's a very beautiful symbolism, and hopefully in a few years' time you'll be able to see the ordination ceremony here when our seminarian finishes his studies. But from Eucharist to man, from man to Eucharist, from Christ to Christ, from generation to generation, from the Last Supper until this day, that is the beauty of the priesthood. These are men who have given up their personal lives in order that the flock of Christ may eat and be nourished. And that is why we owe it during this entire week to pray for the priests who have died before us, who have walked before the veil. Because as I said, being human, we have all of our own human failings that come along in our sins. And so we pray for their forgiveness. But we also in our prayers show that gratitude, that every generation there are men who do say yes and who do step forward. And as Travis, as difficult as you may think this period in the church history is, every period of church history has been difficult. There are almost no generations in which there had not something going on that's not always so convulsive, but there are always convulsions. So we thank our Lord God for having brought this lineage of the priests within the church. We ask for their forgiveness in gratitude to God who gave them to us. And may God raise up many more to come between now and the day of judgment, so that the flock may be nourished, that the household may be guided, that the stewards may give voice to that prophetic word, and we all traverse the synodos together, the pathway together that is the church, that we may come to the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the firstborn. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Son and Lord, and Lord of God, who has spoken through our eyes.
profess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. Itel vot madeb heida loho, qual vot aloho dan chare tayut, Reinus ugot aibuta hokeu lelbay toch veskud ab chayet lo, hod kod ashochem.
Almighty Lord and God, you accepted the offerings of our ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom. As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the chosen one, our Holy Father, Saint Marian, Saint Jude, and Saint Bucolos. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Merciful and holy Lord and Father, through your only begotten Son, you have prepared this spiritual banquet for us. Accept the offering of this bloodless sacrifice, and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and divine love, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, O holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of the Holy Spirit. Blessed be peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit.
Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor with love and faith that are pleasing to God.
Peace. Peace and security and your true love and divine mercy be with us and among us all the days of our lives, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, we bow before you and ask you to look upon us with mercy. Make us worthy to approach your holy altar with pure hearts and holy souls and bodies, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility.
It is right and just.
Truly it is right and just to glorify and praise you, O God the Father, for you are holy and the giver of life. You are blessed with your only begotten Son and your living Holy Spirit. You are surrounded by the cherubim and seraphim, who sing with pure voices and heavenly melodies. They cry out, glorify and proclaim. Ansa belachma mina kori shonto ubaruch hu kodesh. Waksu yabil talmidal kodomarem. Sabachul amene kulchun. Hono denita. Fahadodil. Dachlofaikun wachlat sagiem. Metapaseu metiheb. Husunyon hame wahoye. Dalakalam alamin. Amen. Ho chano alkos odam zichro men hamro men mahayom. Baruch hu kodesh. Uyabil talmidau karo maram. Savishtawa mehne kulchun. Hono denita demo dila diati ki khadato dakhlo faikun wakhlav sagiem te shadu meti heb husoyon khame wa khaye dan qalam alamin Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do so in memory of me until I come again.
We remember your death, O Lord. We profess your resurrection. We await your second coming. We implore your mercy and compassion. We ask for the forgiveness of sins. May your mercy rest upon us.
O Lord, lover of all people, we remember your plan of salvation, and we ask you to have mercy on your worshippers, and to save your inheritance when you appear at the end of time, to reward all people justly according to their deeds. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you, implores your Father, saying,
Have mercy on us, Almighty Father. Have mercy on us.
O Lord, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you. We glorify you. We profess our faith in you and we ask you. Have compassion on us, Lord, and to pardon. Have mercy on us, and hear us. How awesome is this moment, O my beloved, for the living Holy Spirit descends and rests upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Annin Monio, Annin Monio. Annin monio nite mororoch chayu kodisho unachen elaynu al korbono hono. Gano dam machen nuten abed lachmono fachro dam shicho alo dilon.
Amen.
Olam zo cho dam kosono dimodile dam shicho alo dilon. May these holy mysteries be for the forgiveness of sins, the healing of souls and bodies, and the strengthening of consciences, so that none of your faithful may perish. Rather, make us worthy to live by your Spirit and to lead a pure life. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
We all offer you, O Lord, this divine sacrifice for your church, especially for our fathers and shepherds, Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the bishops of the true faith, with blameless lives and with purity and holiness, may they guide your church and present to you a faithful people who honor your name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Remember, O Lord, your people here before you, especially those who presented these offerings. Forgive them so that they may always live blameless lives in your presence and recognize the blessings that you bestow upon them. For you are good and rich in graces. We pray to you, O Lord.
Remember, O Lord, civil leaders throughout the world, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who have pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, Saint Joseph, and assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest, hoping in you, awaiting that life-giving voice, calling them to life. Accept the offerings we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever.
Pleasing oblation, who offered yourself for us.
You are the forgiving sacrifice, who offered yourself to your Father.
You are the high priest, who offered yourself as the Lamb.
Through your mercy, may our prayer rise like incense, which we offer to your Father through you. To you be glory.
Compassionate Lord, may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and with holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Shlomo elokolukhunna.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries with purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and be made holy. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Thank you.
again, we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us. Thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and for the glory of your holy name and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Shlomo el kol chudna. Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation, and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
So there are just two announcements. Next Sunday, you have flyers at the door, the two entrances. Next Sunday after both of the Masses at 9 and at 11, there's a pancake breakfast. And so it is not only to give us another occasion to gather together in a more social environment, but also because it is Super Bowl Sunday. Ruth will be in full lottery mode with taking for the, I don't know, what is this thing?
Numbers.
She's got numbers for the whatever, the game. So anyways, that'll be there too. The most important thing is to see one another and have great bacon. But the other thing is to remind you, it's in the bulletins, that we've left copies from last week because of the blizzards. But you have in them the reminder that this coming Wednesday is the feast of our Holy Father, Saint Maron. So for the Maronites, it's a holy day of obligation. So there will be Mass on the Vigil on Tuesday evening, with Ram Show at 5 p.m. The Mass in the evening will be at 6 p.m. for the Vigil. And then, of course, on the feast day itself at 9 a.m. as usual for the Feast of Saint Maron. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.
And even now, so I have to return to you in peace, with the infirmity of your people, the fullness of our thoughts, and wish of the saints.
And the Lord's time without shame, if you have faith,
do not need to shame your touch.
So I have to be in peace.
Compose the psalter.